arrays. This session, I would like to discuss arrays. Any programming language storing data is a crucial thing. How do you store those data and how do you access them in our program? It's very important when you are using programming language. Arrays are the one of the fundamental methods we are using to store set of data. Usually arrays keeps same types of data. They hold fixed number of same types of data. If you know the size of the data we're going to keep and we know the type of it, the arrays are the best way to store them. So in addition to the arrays, programming languages have different, what you call different data structures to store those data. We call them as lists, directories, structures, unions, and so on. So let's discuss today the basic data structure which holds same type of fixed number of data. So for example, let's say our programs want to keep marks of 100 students. So we know we have only 100 students in the class. And what we're going to keep is marks. Then we know the type of the data, maybe they are integers. So then we can create an array to keep them. So when you discuss arrays, there are two types we can understand, identify. We call them as one-dimensional arrays and multi-dimensional arrays. How do you declare an array? So when you want to declare an array in C, first of all, we have to give a data type and then the name for this array. And then we put a square bracket, and within this square bracket, we give the size of this array. So this size of the array is fixed. So we have to declare it at the beginning. So for example, when we want to keep marks, so we can create an array called marks. The size is 5 and the type is float. Since we want to have decimal numbers, maybe we can create this array as float. So when you create such array, the computer will reserve 5 slots in the memory to keep 5 floating point numbers. So we can access those with indexes. So starting from 0. So the first slot we call it as 0, and the second one, and the third 2, 4, 3, and the last one is 4. Indexes start from 0. So that is important. So if you have 5 elements of the array, first element is 0 and the last element is 4, not 5. So if there are n elements in the array, the last element is n minus 1. So basically, when you create an array, the name of the array keeps the address of the first element. So in our example, let's say mark 0 keeps the address of the first element, assume that is 2120D in hexaform. Then next address will be 2124D. So because there may be 4 bytes required to store floating point number. So usually array name keep the address of the first element. If we know the size of this array size is fixed, then we can calculate the last element as well. How many elements in the array? Because we can access each element by increasing the memory address by 4. If it is a floating point number and not take 4 bytes to store, then the array size will be increased 4 by 4. And you want to access the array, basically we don't use addresses, even though I explain it with addresses, we are using array indexes. When you're declaring arrays, same time we can initialize those arrays. So for example, here I am initializing an array called marks, types is integer, and we could use curly brackets, and within that, I can give the initial elements. So here see I have given 5 elements. So the each element will assign to each slot of the array. So when you ask mark 0, let me give the array name, square bracket 0, we can take the first element and mark, and then square bracket, within the square bracket we say 1, it returns the second element and so on. So by using square bracket and giving the index number there, we can individually access elements stored in the array. Not only access, we can write to this slot plus read from this slot. For example, let's say we want to read some elements, 5 integers, from the keyboard instead of initializing it at the declaration time, like instead of giving the values at the beginning, at the declaration point, let's say we want to read them from the keyboard. So how can we do that? So here the method we can do that. So we here create an array called values with 5 elements. So if we want to read those 5 integers from the keyboard, so we could use a for loop, very simply. So we initialize a for loop here, you see, for integer, starting from I, we create an integer I. So this I is declared inside the for loop, so then this I is not affected to any I in the program. So it we initialize it to 0, and we increase I by 1 until it less than 5. Then in the scanf, we say value I. Value array name square bracket I. So we check the index. So since we want the address of that scanf require address, we put this ampersand sign or the address of that. That's how we read elements to arrays. So in the first time it enters, value of I is 0, then it asks the system to read value 0, that first sentence. Then it passes value I and so on by increasing I 1 by 1. Let's say we want to print them on the terminal. So what should we do? Simply, we can use a for loop. We know the size of the array is 5. So then we write a for loop, runs from 0 to 4, like here. And using just printf, we pass value I. So first time the I is 0, then it pass value 0. And then I will be increased by 1, then it pass value 1, and then values 2, values 3, and values 4. So this for loop to print each and every value on the terminal. Right. You know now how to read and print it. Let's say we have stored some data in array, and we want to get a total of those numbers. Maybe plus average. How do you do that? Think about it. Here is the my solution. Assume I have marks of 5 students. So in a marks array. So I create an array called marks with 5 elements. And in this simple for loop, I scan marks of those 5 cells. So this for loop runs from 0 to 4. And using scanf, I put each and every indexes and then read marks and store them in each slots in this array. So this file will read the marks. After that, what I would like to do is total them and take the average. What do I do? In order to total them, here I have a for loop. There what I do, you see, I create another integer equal to 0. And then I use a for loop here, again runs from 0 to 4. And add the marks value to the total. So in the first run, I 0, then marks, it comes mark 0. The mark 0 will add to the total and assign that to the total. So that is plus equal means. The initially total is 0. 0 will add to the first element and the result will assign to the total. So then I will be increased by 1 and then it comes here back and marks I value will be taken and then add to the total and assign back to the total. Then marks 2 will be taken, 3 will be taken and so on. Finally, after execution of this for loop, finally total has the addition of all elements in that array. Right, now we want to take the average. Average is total divided by number of elements in simple speaking. So when you divide total by the number of elements, so we should get the average. But usually average, when you take the average, it has decimal places for decimal. It should be a floating point number. So since this total is integer and we divide by the integer, usually the C returns an integer as answer. So that means if you answer as some decimal values or the fractions, C kind of drop those. So for example, let's say total is 9. The 9 divide 5, there is a decimal numbers, right? So that may not take, it's only take the integer. Assume we want to take the answer as float. If we want to specify the returning value of some calculation, we can do what we call it as casting. In the programming language, sometimes those casting is important. Otherwise, so we may, especially in the calculations, we might lose some fractional values. So for example, I want to emphasize the system. After this division, I would like to get a floating point value. So that I have to do quite kind of casting. So there what I do, put 2 brackets here and then put the type which I want to get it. So if I don't do this float, it by default return integer and assign that integer value in the float, then definitely I may not have any decimal places. So if I do this, say, casting to the float, answer it will take it as it floating point numbers, and that floating point number will assign to the ABG variable. When I do the demonstration, I will show you what happens here. Right. So in there, I print the total and the average of the term. So you see, so this simple program demonstrated to you how do you manipulate the elements in the array. So you can access each elements using indexes. So there we can use a for loop to change that index values. Strings. In C programming language, consider C programming language, consider as a fundamental programming language, and they don't have strings. If we want to store a sentence or a name, so we have to declare a character array to store it. In a way, strings are the set of characters. So we can store each letters, then each character. In a character array, the result is a string. So for example, so here is the characters for C string tutorial. This place has a space, this is a space, and all other characters terminated by a null character, zero. So in C, that is how we declare a string. In other words, in the C, string is a character array terminated by a null character. That means if you want to store a name or whatever as a string in the C, we have to create an array. And after put our string, we have to put last character as null character. So then let take it as a string. Then how do you declare string? Or otherwise character, same as we are declaring integer array. So we can declare character array called S with 5 characters. So in the first letter will be stored in the 0th place. And the second letter will store in the first place, second and so on. So simply strings are a character. How do you initialize them? We can initialize a character array in different methods. So we can give a double quoted values and then say C, it's automatically put there. Or we can give number of elements we want and put that. Or we can use just C without giving the size inside and give each elements. So for example, let's say we have like 4 characters in our string. So we have to have 5 characters. So that you have to remember. Let's say we define a 50 character array to store 4 characters. So what's happened in the first 4, they will store these first 4 characters. And then the fourth element actually, indexes starting from 0, the fourth element, they store the null character. So similar to here. It usually shows here A, B, C, D, and null. So we should have 5 elements in case we want to store 4 element characters or as a string. Right. How do you read a string in the C? So we have several methods to read strings to our C program from the terminal. Simple way is again using scanf. In the scanf, even though we don't have the type called string, so in the scanf there is a formatted character called S. So if you want to read the name, so we can create a character array, maximum size is 20. And then using scanf, we can pass the array name. So when you are passing the array names to the scanf here, so we don't need to pass the ampersand sign because anyway name contains the address. Name contains the address of the first element of the array. Because of that, we don't need to specifically put ampersand sign here in front of this array name. But in case we put a square bracket and put the index value inside, then it won't return address. So then we should put the ampersand sign. So here we want to read a string and store those strings from the first element. onwards. So we just pass the name of the array. Using scanf, we can do that. But scanf read the characters until it reach the empty or space. So let's say we want to read entire line, multiple words. In other words, here scanf read only single words. If you want to read multiple words, there is a method called getS. Similar to scanf, there is a one called getS. So using getX, we can pass the array name to getX. It reads the string from the keyboard and store it in the name. Unfortunately, this getX, when reads the name, they don't check the array boundaries. So its array boundaries are very important. Array boundary means the last element of the array. So array values are stored in the memory. So if it is a 5 element of the array, you should not try to store the 6th element in the array. If you do so, it will destroy the data of some other variables or maybe some other program. So when you are storing the data or accessing the data, programmer has to check those array boundaries, whether it is less than the size. Usually, unfortunately, getX won't do that. If you use getX to read the names, if someone enter 50 characters, so since we declare only 730 character here, the 50 characters, after the 30, they might store the data continuously on the memory by destroying the other variables. So because of that, we are not advised to use getX now. Instead of, there is another method available called fgetX. fgetX is suitable to read strings by line by line on the keyboard. It could use to read the data from the files as well. You might learn it later on. So the format of the fgetX is syntax of the fgetX, something like that. The first argument is the name, and the second argument is the size of the array, and the last argument is where we're going to read. Std in means standard input. We're going to read it from standard input, this much of characters, and store it in the name. We can get a size of the array at any time by using a command called sizeof. So we pass sizeof to the name of the array, it returns size of the array. So since it declares 30 elements, 30 elements of the array here, so size of name will return 30. So then, if someone tried to enter more than 30 character elements, so that will return the error. So we can stop, kind of, that will actually cut off the values more than 30 elements. So because of that, it is safer. It may not overwrite the memory after the array boundaries. So because of that, we recommend to use getX. Instead of getX, we recommend to use fgetX. Instead of printf, if you wish, we can use another command called putx. Putx just print the characters till it hit the null character. So if you have strings like set of character array available, we can use putx to print that instead of printf. So like putx, fgetx, there are several string related methods available in C, or string manipulation methods. So those methods are defined in a separate library module called string library. So header file of that is called string.h. String.h. So in case you want to use those string manipulation functions, so you have to input string.h into your program. Similarly, you are including standard STDIOH, standard input output H header files into your program. You should include string.h into your program. So after you include that, all the declaration of those methods will come into your source file and you can use those in your program. And at the compilation and linking time, the seek link compiler will take those from the libraries and incorporate it into your application. Right. So when you use C programs, there is a very interesting concept, call it as command line arguments. So for example, when you run a program at the command line, in case you want to pass some values to your program, you can use command line arguments. So you know, C programs consist of functions. So the main function in the C program is the main. So you know, the C program start execution from the main function. So far our main program or the main function, we use int main and the bracket. Within the bracket, we don't use any arguments or any input parameters. If you wish, main function can have input arguments as well. So if you dig, you can define two inputs parameters to the main function called int and character point. We will discuss pointers later on. It's actually array of pointers, or we call it as multidimensional array. We discuss in multidimensional arrays. So in basically what's happened, whatever you type at the command line will assign to this string array. And how many elements in that string array will assign to this args? So I said string array. When you take one string, it is a character array. One string is a character array. Then set of strings are the multidimensional character arrays. This is how we can define multidimensional character array. It's called command line arguments. We can give any name here. It's an argument name. And the type is integer. This is character. It's called as pointer. So we discuss later on what it is. So we will see how we could use that command line. So for example, let's say at the time of you are executing the program, after the program name, you type one more parameter. So then argc or the becomes two. So if you type two more input values, argc becomes three. So using the argv variable, by putting zero we can access the first element, and putting one we can access the second element. So usually the first element always the program name. So at the terminal you type the program name to be executed. So then argv zero is the program name. So whatever you type after the program name goes to argv 1, 2, 3, and 4, and so on. So command line argument, that method is used to enter parameters to a main function. So we can use the main function without having parameters like that, or we can put these two parameters, integer and string point or string array. So at the time when you are executing that program, so we can pass different words or the parameters to that Yes. So you may have already experience when you write, when you use command line tools, so such as like moon. We say moon, the source, and the destination. So it has then three parameters. Command name, that is MB, and the source name, and the destination name. So the command name goes to the zero, and the destination name goes to the one, and the source name goes to two. So like that, we can access the data we pass. So as an example, let's say I wrote a simple C program here and compile it here and runs that without any parameter. So here in my main function has two inputs. That means it takes the command line arguments. Here I put the RGC value, that is this integer, which tells how many arguments for you passes to this program. And using for loop, starting from zero to the less than I, by increasing value I one by one, we put the values available here. That means we print the strings available in that array, one by one. So that's what this program do. Assume this program runs that without any parameters here. So the number of parameters one, and we won't get any outputs. So assume we are running that program like that a.out, our program name, and the hello. There are then two inputs parameters. So this one assigned to zero, and this one assigned to one. So there are two parameters then. The program will print program name, and the second parameter hello. So assume we run that like that, program name, hello, and custom. Then there are three command line arguments. First one is always the name of the program, a.out. The second one is hello, and third one is custom. Like that, we can pass several command line arguments to our program and access that inside the program. So that's how we interact from the terminal directly with the program. So this is multidimensional array. So how do you define such multidimensional array? So there's one way of defining it like that, so you may understand that definition after you learn pointers. The most meaningful method of kind of simple way of declaring a multidimensional array like that. So here we declare multidimensional array called float. The name of that array is X. It has three rows and four columns. So here how it would look like. So here there is a X two-dimensional array, can hold 12 elements, 3 × 4, 3 rows, and 4 columns. Altogether, we can store 12 decimal numbers. So when you want to access the first cell, it is 0, 0. Then 0, 1 is the second, 0, 2 is the third, 0, 4 is the 0, 3 is the fourth. So this is first one is the row number, and this last one is the column number. So in the second row we can access with 1, third row we can access with 2, and then column number. By giving the row number and the column number, we can access the elements in that such multidimensional array. Command line arguments is multidimensional character array. These columns contain the characters, and rows consist of each words. So you understand that. So not only two dimension, we can have three dimension like that. Three dimensional arrays. Kind of complicated. But if you wish, you can define four dimensions and so on. So any number of dimensions we can define, or we can use by declaring arrays in C. So in practically, we use one dimensional arrays and two dimensional arrays. So very rarely we require higher dimensional arrays in our programs. Other important thing while you are using arrays, how do you pass those arrays to the functions? We already know how to pass variables to the functions. We declare those variables and we pass the values to those variables and then we execute those functions. We experience that. Can we do the same with the arrays? Yes, we can. When you pass the arrays to functions, so usually we pass the name of the array. Name of the array consists of the address of the first element, as I mentioned. So because of that, we say we pass the arrays to functions as reference. So to understand that, we should understand the methods we are using to pass arguments to the functions. So we already learned functions. So let's say this is our main function. There we call a function called increment count. So this is our callee. This is a caller. Main is the caller function. Caller function will call the callee functions. We learn within this callee function, we can call the same function as well. So that's what we call it as recursions. You remember we learned that as well. Anyway, let's take a simple situation. There is a main function. The caller is the main function, callee is some other function. So caller will pass some arguments to the callee. So that's called it as caller arguments, call it as actual parameters. Callee arguments, call it as formal parameters. So when you pass such variables to the callee, usually it passes by value. Pass by value means, so we usually what's happened, the value of this variable, put it into the stack, what we call program stack. That was assumed that is in the memory. The system will create a copy of this variable in the memory. That copy is accessed by this callee function. That means the original keep as it is, caller variable value keep as it is in the computer memory, and it make a copy, and this copy is accessed within this callee function. So that's the usual way of passing arguments, or the most common method of passing arguments to the function. So if you do change that value we pass to the function, that may not reflect back into the main. No, we pass the value and this value will be used within this function. And after we do some calculation, we might return some data from this function. The returning data we can assign to some other variable here, but the whatever the variable we pass us here may not reflect back to the caller. In simple speaking, if the callee modifies the parameter value, that effect is not visible to the caller. So that's how we are calling the function so far. But array uses a different method. Different methods means array passes the memory address. Instead of the value, array passes the memory address. Because of that, we say it passed by reference. So we can pass variables also as address, we will learn later on. Pass by reference means instead of passing the copy of that parameter, we are passing the memory address of this parameter to this callee. So obviously if you pass the memory address, if something changes here at the callee, that will reflect to the caller. So arrays passes as by reference. So in order to understand that, you can execute these two simple programs. So for example, there is a function here in the main program, main function. There is an integer called in, and we call this function on declare on the top with this integer variable in. So then what happened? Copy of that value in this variable passes to this function, then that in become 1. So in that, inside the function, we change that to 2. That only affect locally here. So in other words, this in and this in is two different variables in the memory. So this in is local to this function. So if you do change something here, that only reflected within the function, it not returning or take any effect to this function. Because of that, after this function call, when you call printf in with this variable, we gets 1 printed on the term, not the 2. If you print in variable inside the function, obviously that is 2. Call changes may not affect to the call that is passed by value. So let's assume we pass array. So for example, here I am declare array and initialize like here with 3 elements, 1, 2, 3. There is then 3 element array called AR. And we call the function, we pass that AR array to this function. So here there is a function which takes the input parameter as array. It is int array, right? And inside this function, we change the element of this array. Zeroth element we assign 4, and this first element we assign 5, and then 6. We change the elements of this array we pass. And then we print that the first element, that is the, this one, the zeroth element, this is the set, first element. Index is starting from 0. So it you may think it print 2 because it is 2. However, it is not. It print 5. Why? So arrays passes as references. So when you call this function with this array name, so it make a copy of this address, array address, and pass that address to there. So then this AR and this AR referring to the same memory address. So when using this array accessing methods, when you access those array, so we are accessing the same place in the memory from the callee as well. Because of that, if we do change anything in the callee, that reflect to the caller. So we get 5 printed, not 2. So because of that, you need to be very mindful when you're passing arrays to the functions. It is different than passing variables to the functions. When you pass variables to the functions in C, it passes as values. When you pass arrays to the function, it passes as by reference. So I will show some demos in a separate video so you can understand it better. All right. Now there is exercise. So you have to do that yourself. So there I'm asking you to write a C program to reverse a given sentence. So you type something on the terminal, you need to print it in the reverse order. So then I ask you to write a program to calculate or kind of get the number of characters in a string, frequency of given character in a string. So for example, so there I request you to type use a command line arguments. So use your program name, let's say calculate frequency. So you, then you, when you write calculate frequency with one character F and the sentence. So your program should print how many F exist in the second command line now. In the third, I'm asking you to write a program to add and multiply matrices. So in the matrices, you know, are two-dimensional arrays. So two matrices, if you want, let's say there are two matrices, which assume they are integers, as A and B. So this is how we could add two matrices. When you add matrix A to matrix B, matrix A is a two-dimensional array. Matrix B also two-dimensional array. Then you want to add them, so we have to add first element here. With the first element here, you create the element there, like that. So this is the definition of matrix addition. So this is the definition of matrix multiplication. So like if you want to multiply these two matrices together, so you have to multiply first element with this and add, then multiply this element with this and add them together to create the first element of the result. That's how we define the matrix multiplication. So study this matrix addition and matrix multiplication and write two functions to perform this matrix addition and multiplication. And then complete a program where people can enter a two matrices from the terminal, and your program will output the addition of these two matrices and multiplication of these two matrices. As an exercise of this session, you have to complete these three programs. So I will upload that exercise as assignment to the LMS. With that, we will conclude this session today. Thank you.